Going from decimal to binary is a bit more of a challenge, and here's the conversion algorithm. First, for your original decimal number, you would start by identifying the largest power of 2, which is less than or equal to your original number. Then, subtract that power of 2 from your decimal number to obtain a remainder. Then you would repeat this process over and over again until you've driven the remainder down to 0. At this point, you've decomposed your original number into a sum of terms which are all powers of 2. What you do then is express those powers of 2 as a series of 1 or 0 coefficients. If a power of 2 term is present, it's represented by a 1 coefficient. If a power of 2 term is absent, then it's represented by a 0 coefficient. Your resulting binary number is then just this series of 1s and 0s. This set of steps is probably a bit confusing here in the abstract. So let's take a look at a concrete example of this. Here's an example of performing a decimal to binary conversion. Suppose we want to take decimal 47 and convert it into binary. The first thing we do is find the biggest power of 2 that fits into 47. Well, 64 is too large, so we start with 32. We subtract 32 from 47 to get a remainder of 15. So now we repeat the process on this remainder of 15. Well, now 16 is too big, so we can decompose 15 into 8 with a remainder of 7. We decompose 7 into 4 with a remainder of 3. We decompose 3 into 2 with a remainder of 1. And 1 obviously decomposes into 1, and now we have a remainder of 0. So what we've done is we've broken down this original decimal number of 47 into a sum of terms which are all factors of 2, as shown here. So what we do for each factor of 2 term which is present, we put a coefficient of 1 in the ultimate binary result. But notice here that we have a 2 to the 4th term that's missing, and we can't overlook that. That's a common mistake. So what we'll do instead is we'll put a 0 for any terms in the expansion which are missing. So we get 1 for the 2 to the 5th, a missing 2 to the 4th term, a 1 for the 2 to the 3rd, a 1 for the 2 to the 2nd, a 1 for the 2 to the 1, and a 1 for a 2 to the 0, which of course is 1. This then is the binary equivalent of hex 47. So this 1 in the lowest significant bit is just sort of a reality check on this being an odd number. And that's how we convert decimal to binary. The conversion from decimal to hex is even more of a challenge, but it's similar to the last one, and here's that algorithm. As before, for your decimal number, now you would start by identifying the largest power of 16, which is less than or equal to your original decimal number. Now you would divide your original number by that power of 16 to find out how many whole times it will divide the original number. Then you'd subtract the product of the whole number of times times its power of 16 from the original decimal number to get a remainder. And as before, you would repeat this process over and over again until you've driven the remainder down to 0. Again, what you've done is broken up your original number into a sum of terms which are some coefficients times powers of 16. You would then collect up those coefficients, except turn them into hex digits, and then you would have the desired equivalent hex number. Once again, this set of steps is probably quite confusing here in the abstract. So let's take a look at another concrete example of this conversion. Here's an example of how to go about converting decimal to hex. Suppose we've got the decimal number 500 and we want to convert it from decimal into hex. Well, as before, what we ultimately want to do is express this as a sum of terms which are all factors of 16. So for example, what's the biggest power of 16 that will fit into 500? Well, 4096 is too big, so the next power of 16 is 16 to the 2, or 256. So then we ask ourselves, How many times will 256 fit into 500? So if we do some standard division, we find it goes in one time with a remainder of 244. So this 1 is the coefficient for the 16 to the 2 term. Then we simply repeat the process on the remainder. So we ask ourselves, what's the biggest power of 16 that will go into 244? Obviously 256 is too big, so the answer is 16. But then we ask ourselves, how many times will 16 go into 244? So if we perform that division, 16 goes into 244 15 times with a remainder of 4. So this 15 is the coefficient for the 16 to the 1 term. And again, we repeat the process on the remainder of 4. So what's the biggest power of 16 that will go into 4? Well, it's 1, which is 16 to the 0. So obviously 1 will go into 4 4 times with a remainder of 0. So because we've driven the remainder to 0, we know we're done. So this 4 is the coefficient for the 16 to the 0 term. If we then collect all these coefficients, 1, 15, and 4, and of course we recognize that 15 gets translated into the hex digit F, if we collect these terms up, our answer is 1F4hex. Now, by convention, we might want to put this into even numbers of hex digits. So we'll zero pad it on the left and add this 0x. And so our final answer will be hex 01F4 is the equivalent of decimal 500. So here's a question for you. Given this number, 100, how can I tell what it represents? Is it decimal 100 like pennies in a dollar? Is it binary 4? Or is it a hex 256? We can't make any clear determination until we know a little more specific context. We need to know in which of the three numbering systems this number is represented. If we're talking decimal, then of course this is the expected 100. If we're in binary, then this is equal to decimal 4. Or if we're in hex, then this is equal to decimal 256. The point here, of course, is now that we know about multiple numbering systems, we might need to know more specifically which system we're using, unless it's pretty obvious from the context of the situation. Here's a similar question. Given some numbers such as these, without any specific numbering system indicated, how can we tell what the number is or isn't? This first number is very ambiguous. Since the 1 and 0 symbols are common to all three numbering systems, this number could be in binary, decimal, or hex, and we'd need some more specifics to tell which it is. This second number is still ambiguous, but a bit less so. Because of this 7 digit, we know it can only be decimal or hex, because binary only has 1s and 0s. But we still need some more specifics to determine decimal or hex. This last number is completely unambiguous. It has to be hex because neither binary nor decimal has this C digit. So the message here is, if there is possible ambiguity in a number, provide some context to make clear whether a number is expressed in decimal, binary, or hex. Okay, that's it for this topic on number conversions. With these procedures and examples, you should have enough to go on to complete your number conversions assignment. Feel free to message me in Canvas if you have any questions or difficulties on that assignment.